Good morning. What an amazing fall feeling day outside, huh? We want to welcome you today to Lake Hills United Methodist Church. And my name is Reverend Don Baird. I am the pastor here, and we are so thankful that you are with us in worship today. If you are worshiping with us online, welcome as well. You may want to take a moment, grab some bread or whatever, crackers, whatever you may have, that's kind of a bread item in your house, some juice or wine, whatever it is that you have, because we will be observing communion a little later in the service. If you are also, if you're worshiping with us online, if you will take a moment and in the chat bar, if you will just give us your name, tell us how many people are worshiping with you, that would be fantastic. So we know that you're here with us. If you are here in the sanctuary, if you will take a moment and to grab the attendance pads that are at the end of each pew and let us know that you are here with us as well. Let us now begin to prepare our hearts, our minds, and our souls for worship. You will notice something a little different this morning as we begin to sing our first praise song. You see, over this next month, over the next four Sundays, we're going to be going on kind of a courageous journey, you might say. We're going to examine how each one of us serve God and our church through our talents, our time, even our money. And I know that's a bad word in church, right? But Jesus talked about money a lot in Scripture. So it's not something we should get stressed about. It's just another way of showing God how much we love God. But on this journey over the next 4 weeks, we're going to look at what type of obstacles are on this path that God has put us on. Obstacles are boulders that just keeps us from truly living into what God wants us to do, how God wants us to serve. And so over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be lighting a special candle each week. We're going to do so to remember that God is with us always, even during uncomfortable times, especially those hard, uncomfortable times. And I'm looking in the mirror as I say this, when we have to determine what keeps us from taking that next step into serving, okay? So today, as we light this candle, as Jeanette will light the beautiful candle that is up here, we're going to ask God to illumine these shadowy corners in our lives where we have unspoken yet very powerful fears. We're going to ask God to help us gain new and fresh perspective, to help us push away those boulders of doubts and fears that's keeping us from walking the rest of the way down that path. And we're going to ask God to help us fully embrace God's vision for our lives. Because when we do, we're going to truly live a life that is wonderful. Let us now praise God in song.
Ship. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, I worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your. Time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
so often it's always about needs and wants. Needs and wants. We need to be even more thankful in our prayers. So over this month, I'm asking you to be very purposeful about that. Look around you each and every day. Find ways that you see God's love, God's miracles, God's just amazing grace in action. Make note of them. Immediately in the moment, say, thank you, God. This is unbelievable. Send me those pictures. You can email them to me, text them to me. We're going to be putting some pictures and slideshows together to help us visually remember that being in prayer is not about putting like a quarter in the candy machine and trying to get God to give us what we want. Being in prayer with God is about being in a relationship with God, always thanking God. No matter the circumstance, because God's love and grace never ends. And even in the worst of times, God can do amazing, great, beautiful things. Part of our prayer is going to be, we're going to be praying over about 600 pairs of socks that you all donated over this past month. These will be going up to Hillcrunty Elementary School, and they will be giving them to children whose families at the moment are struggling. They have money to help their children, maybe have shoes, but they don't have enough to just buy socks. This is you showing God's love. So we're going to be praying a blessing over these as well. Let us pray. Gracious God, we come to You this morning in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, and especially God, because You're God. We come not as strangers, but we come as Your children. And we thank You for that. God, no matter what is going around us in our world right now, we thank You for Your mercy and Your grace, that You are always there when we need You. Help us to remember to always be there when You need us. God, we thank You that You have never failed to fulfill Your promises to us in the world.
that no matter what is going on, you can and will do amazing, marvelous things. You help us through it. And again, God, we say thank you and we praise your name for who you are and what you do. God, as we enter into the month of November, we do so earnestly reminding ourselves and telling you that we want to do your will. We want to fulfill your plans and your purposes for us. Forgive us, God, when we get so busy with living in the here and now, that when we let other things in our world become a priority over you. Forgive us, God. Forgive us for the things we do and the things we have left undone. And we thank you, God, and we praise your name because we know as we are saying, forgive us, God, we are sorry, God, you are saying, my child, I love you. That part's gone. I love you. So, God, today we lift up those deep within our hearts who have needs, who are grieving. Whatever the case may be, you know what their needs and our desires are, even better than we do. Lord, we lift them up now to you. And we thank you, God. We thank you because we know that you are with each and every one of them, just as you're with us, and that just takes our breath away. That shows us just how mighty and powerful you are. God, we lift up so many hundreds of socks. Something that's so easy to take for granted. But for those who are struggling, it's maybe a necessity, but it's not something that they can give themselves. So Lord, as these warm the feet of your children, may their hearts be strangely warmed by your love and your grace. Let them know that even if they don't know the individual names of the people who brought and gave these socks, they still know that they are loved, that they are important, and most of all, that they are loved by you. God, we lift up our community and all those around us. We pray for our government officials and those in rulership of all the nations in your world. God, we pray for a spiritual holiness to envelop and cover your world so that it is your will be done, not ours, not anybody in charge or anybody in control. And God, especially remind us it is your will be done and not ours. Help us as we move out of the walls of this building this morning to be your servants, to be your hands, your feet, your heart, and your words to anyone and everyone who needs to hear them. God, we thank you. We can't say that enough. We thank you. We thank you. Oh, we thank you, God. And we praise your name and we lift it above all others. As we pray this in the name of Jesus the Christ, who is our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Let us continue our worship and song.
Worship you. worship you, 'cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 'Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here. You are here. Touch me. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. Healing every life. I worship you. I worship.
Say that. So if, when you go to buy a pumpkin to make it into a jack-o'-lantern, do you look for the best, the most awesome, greatest looking pumpkin? The most unique, unusual maybe looking pumpkin? I know I do. Might be one that other people might go, I'm not too sure, but I'm like, that is so cool and awesome. Guess what?
It's what God thinks about all of us, each and every one of us. Even if we think we don't look like the other pumpkins in the patch. Maybe we got little warts, might not be fully orange. God thinks we're beautiful and amazing and the best there is. So then, what's the next step to making a jack-o'-lantern? The bandage on my finger should tell you. We cut it open, right? Yes. So we will take, I brought the kitchen knife, this different knife there. So you know, we cut it open, right? We pull the top off. So then what do? We have to like take all that yucky stuff out, right? This stuff right here? The stuff, right? So we take that out. Well, guess what? That's what God does. You see, God doesn't want us filled with yucky stuff like being rude or being mean or hurting other people or just anything that's yucky and not so good and nice. God helps us to take all of that away when we lean into who God wants us to be. The yuckiness inside of us goes far, far away and disappears. Now then, what do? We got all the yuckiness out. It's like missing something, right? Yeah. So we start cutting. We want to give it. And I'm not like the people on Pinterest and social media that does the real fancy ones. Even David laughed this morning at this. Right? We give it a face. Right? And notice it has a smiling face. Well, that's like being a Christian. We can smile because, one, we love God, but more importantly, we smile because God loves us. Now, the last and probably the most important step. If this was dark, would you be able to see anything? No. And we live in a world that can be dark quite often. People hurting other people, wars that are going on, just mean and just yucky stuff all over, right? But what we do so that we can see this is we put a light in it, right? So our jack-o'-lantern will shine no matter what. God does that for us. God puts a light, which is God's love and grace, deep within us, so that then we go and share that light. We go and share God's love and peace and grace with others, no matter how dark or mean or sad their life happens to be, because that little bit of light that you can offer them is going to pierce that darkness and make a huge, huge difference. So I think that's pretty cool, huh? You can now go around saying, I am a jack-o'-lantern. No. Well, I mean, if you want to, that's fine. And if you do, get a video because I wanted to put it on the church social media pages. But just remember, just as we change this pumpkin into something amazing and awesome, God does the same with us. We just have to let God do it. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you that you change us from the inside out. That you believe and know that we are amazing and awesome and that we are beautiful. That you will help to get us rid of the yucky stuff that's deep inside of us so that our heart is more like yours. Because of your love, we smile. And then most importantly, help us to shine your light into a world that so needs it. We pray this now in the name of Jesus. Because Jesus is just so cool. Amen. Thank you.
I'm going to read the scripture from Matthew 22:15-22:22. Then the Pharisees met together to find a way to trap Jesus in his words. They sent their disciples along with the supporters of Herod to him. Teacher, they said, we know that you are genuine and that you teach God's way as it really is. We know that you are not swayed by people's opinions, because you don't show favoritism. So tell us what you think. Does the law allow people to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Knowing their evil motives, Jesus replied, "Why do you test me, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used to pay the tax." And they brought him a denarian. "Whose image inscription is this?" he asked. "Caesar's," they replied. Then he said, "Give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and to God what belongs to God." When they heard this, they were astonished, and they departed. This is the word of God for all people. Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me, please? Gracious God, we thank you for your word, that while sometimes we may not fully understand what it means, we know you open our hearts and minds to it exactly at the moment we need to know what it is you're wanting us to learn. So today, Lord, as your word is proclaimed, may it change us like a jack-o'-lantern from the inside out, so that as we leave this place, your light shines greatly to those who need it, along with ourselves. So now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable unto you. We pray this now in the powerful name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Joseph, Jesus, and Mary, help my friend, Mr. Bailey.
Help my son, George, tonight.
He never thinks about himself, God. That's why he's in trouble.
George is a good guy. Give him a break, God.
I love him, dear Lord. Watch over him tonight.
Please, God, something's the matter with Daddy. Please bring Daddy back.
Hello, Joseph. Trouble?
Looks like we'll have to send someone down. A lot of people asking for help for a man named George Bailey.
George Bailey? Yes, tonight's his crucial night. You're right. We'll have to send someone down immediately. Whose turn is it?
That's why I came to see you, sir. It's that clockmaker's turn again.
Oh, Clarence hasn't got his wings yet, has he?
We passed him up right along. Because, you know, sir, he's got the IQ of a rabbit.
Yes, but he's got the faith of a child. Simple. Joseph, send for Clarence.
You sent for me, sir?
Yes, Clarence. A man down on Earth needs our help.
Splendid. Is he sick?
No, worse. He's discouraged. At exactly 10:45 p.m. Earth time, that man will be thinking seriously of throwing away God's greatest gift.
Oh, dear, dear, his life. Then I've only an hour to dress. What are they wearing now?
You will spend that hour getting acquainted with George Bailey.
Sir, if I should accomplish this mission, I mean, might I perhaps win my wings? I've been waiting for over 200 years now, sir, and people are beginning to talk.
What's that book you've got there?
Oh, The Adventures of Tom Sawyer.
Clarence, you do a good job with George Bailey, and you'll get your wings.
Oh, thank you, sir.
From the opening of a classic Christmas movie called It's a Wonderful Life. You may be going, what in the world? It's October 31st, Halloween, Christmas movie. Yes, I am doing the Hobby Lobby version of church today, okay? So
But just hang with me. I'll explain what we're doing here. In this clip, we hear people who are worried about a man named George Bailey, and we especially hear God talking to Clarence the Angel about George Bailey. Because you see, George is discouraged. Basically, George feels like his life is now collapsing around him. There's an $8,000 deposit missing from his business's bank account, and a government auditor is now there to look into this further and check the books. So now this building and loan business that George has invested his life into is going to fail. George is pretty worried. He thinks he's probably going to be going to jail. He feels like he's letting down all the people who are depending on him. So now a loss of $8,000 would be hard for us today, right? If we were to lose $8,000. This movie, though, was made in 1946. Guess how much that would be in today's money? $112,537.44. So imagine waking up, opening up your bank account, and that much money is gone. Man, talk about like a punch in the stomach, right? That's what's happening to George. So George Bailey, if you have not seen the movie, and if you haven't, watch it. I'm going to be putting in the next week a link up to it on our webpage, so you can watch it through there. But I thought I'd at least spare it. Not put it up on Halloween. I'd wait for a couple of days, right? But watch it. It's a great movie. In this movie, we have George Bailey, who's a man. He works so hard to make others happy. He's a man who tries to keep his priorities, well, what he thinks are priorities, in order. But yet he still has money controlling his life to the point that when he loses it, he's seriously considering committing suicide because this $8,000 loss is going to ruin him. Not just financially, but in the eyes of others. And yes, this is a Christmas movie. Ho, 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 holly jolly, right? Pretty dark subject for a Christmas movie. But if you watch it to the end, it does lighten up, I promise. So over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be using this movie, It's a Wonderful Life, and we're going to be looking at the characters to help us look deeper into the S word. No, not that S word. The S word I'm talking about is stewardship. Because you see, in churches, stewardship is a word that often has a bad rap. People automatically think that the church, when they say the word stewardship, is saying, show me the money, right? But stewardship is so much more than that. Christian stewardship refers to the responsibility that we as Christians, the responsibility that we have in not only maintaining, but especially using wisely all the gifts that God gives us. You see, God wants us and God needs us to be God's collaborators in the work of creation, redemption, and sanctification. And that's why stewardship is so important. Stewardship is not about, ordering your finances and all the gifts that God gives you in a way that you can just spend and do whatever you want. See, it's about ordering your life in a way that God can spend you in ways that God needs. Think about it this way. In a few years, everything that you have right now will either belong to someone else, be broken, might be thrown away. That is every single thing that's materialistic in your life. Your house, your car, your clothing, your books, your most prized possessions. And that's not what God is saying for us to do. You see, stewardship means we don't make everything about ourselves. We don't use all that God gives us and consume it just on ourselves. But instead, we are to honor God using all that God gives us by being faithful with our prayers, our presence, not presence like the rap, presence like our physical being, our gifts, our service, and our witness. So for these next 4 weeks, as I said, we're going to use the movie It's a Wonderful Life to examine our very deep attitudes towards stewardship as part of a bigger picture of what we're being called to do by God. Now, I absolutely love this movie, It's a Wonderful Life. Just because, you know, it's a feel-good story at the end, right? But I think it explores much deeper themes that are connected to the holidays. about things that we think are traditionally about what holidays are to be. Values of basic goodness and sacrifice. The gift of friendship. The gift of love. The pitfalls of greed and consumerism. The sense of community and belonging. What helps us to feel connected. You watch commercials starting out, it's all about that type of stuff. But it's supposed to be deeper when we're doing it in our faith as Christians. It's all about being more open to appreciate the wonders of God in our lives and then encouraging others to be able to do the same. Or kind of like the angel Clarence does for George Bailey in this movie. So here's a trivial pursuit question for each one and every one of you. So on what form of American currency, coin or bill, and those of you who work in the bank cannot say or answer, but in what American form of currency, coin or bill, does the words "In God We Trust" appear on? Let me hear your answer. So I'm going to give you some answers. Is it A, coins only, B, paper money only, or C, on both? And if you are watching us online, type in your response. A, coins only, paper only, B, C, on all. Well, if you answered C, ding, 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 you're the winner. Guess what you win? Ding, 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 that's your prize. Okay. So, in 1956, the 84th Congress passed a joint resolution declaring "In God We Trust" to be the national motto of the United States. And it's from that moment on that "In God We Trust" appeared on all American currency, coin, and bills. But you see, at the time, the motivation wasn't quite as Christian as we'd like to think it was. The motivation was to distinguish the United States of America from the communists of the Cold War. So if we look at it that way, then "In God We Trust" is more a statement about political power, right, than about theology and faith in God. In fact, as I was reading about this, I read a quote from Mark Twain that says this, "In God We Trust." I don't believe it would sound any better if it were true. And the motto states a lie. If this nation has ever trusted in God, that time has gone by. Because for nearly half a century, almost its entire trust has been in the government and the dollar, and mainly the dollar. Well, that's a big ouch, huh? Basically, Mark Twain was saying America's trust in money was above our trust in God. And we're not the first to intertwine money in politics and theology. We heard all about it in today's scripture reading that Jeanette read for us. That was the crux of that scene in today's gospel reading. We have the Pharisees, the religious leaders of the day. But they're not quite so religious in what's happening and going on right now. You see, they're getting a little angry. They're embarrassed, probably a little fearful. But they're just mad because this guy, Jesus, keeps showing them up. Jesus isn't following the rules. People are beginning to follow this guy, Jesus, instead of the Pharisees and their laws. And it makes the Pharisees ticked off. They begin thinking and saying, just who does this Jesus fellow think he is? How dare he usurp our authority? Enough is enough, and we're going to make him stop. And so they began to decide that it's time for paybacks. And they began to plot, how are they going to trap Jesus to get people to think, hey, maybe Jesus isn't such the greatest thing now. The Pharisees even bring in the Herodians as co-conspirators. You see, that's big, because the Pharisees are anti-Roman. But they are so intent on destroying, on bringing down Jesus, that they are going to join forces with the Herodians. Herodians are people who are pro-Romans, who support Roman domination of the Pharisees' own people. So think about it in that light. We have politics, anger, and fear. Now we've got a dangerous combination that's going to make for unlikely alliances. And that's what we hear in today's scripture reading. So first the Pharisees, as they're talking with Jesus, begin with flattery. Teacher, we know that you are sincere. We know you teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and you show no deference to no one. for you do not regard people with partiality. Oh, they are buttering Jesus up, right? It's like the child who breaks something, they come up and go, Mommy, I love you and you're so pretty. That's what the Pharisees are doing. They are hoping that Jesus will let down his guard so that they can trap him. So Jesus, what do you think, they ask? Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or what? Oh, they're pulling out all the stops now. You see, if Jesus says yes to that question, Jesus now risks offending and losing his followers and future followers, because for those people, the Roman taxation is this daily reminder that they struggle under this heavy yoke of Roman oppression. But if Jesus says no to their question, well, now Jesus risks being charged with mutiny and treason. The Pharisees believe they have Jesus backed in a corner, that Jesus is in a no-win situation. And so Rome's supporters, the Herodians, are there as witnesses. And the Pharisees, you can just see, they're probably just rubbing their hands together and they're smirking, going, we've got him. We've got him now. However, in true Jesus fashion, Jesus turns the question back on them. He rejects the simple either or of that question, and instead he says back to them, why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for tax. And then he asks, whose image is on this coin? Well, the emperor's, the Pharisees answer. And Jesus says back to them, give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's. You see, Jesus is refusing to play into this game that the Pharisees is trying to start. Jesus doesn't answer that question in the way they want. Instead, he deepens that question, and he turns it into a question about faith and life. That coin belongs to Caesar, but human beings belong to God. You see, that Roman coin bears the face of its source. It bears the face, has the face of Caesar on it. And so, yes, that coin belongs to the emperor. But Jesus reminds them and is reminding us today that we bear the image of God. Each and every one of us are children of God, and all of our fair faces bear this unmistakable imprint of God. God's inscription is upon us. A permanent, indelible inscription. And because of that, we belong to God. So if we belong to God, then that means we are to render unto God all things that are God's. When we claim our identity as Christians, when we say that we are followers of Jesus Christ, and all those things that are of God, well, here's just a list of them. Our lives, our time, our talents, our possessions, all of it. Everything in our life is of God because they're instruments that can be used for the accomplishment of God's just and loving will. So as we say that, we think about that, then what does faithfulness, what does belonging to God look like in our world today? If there was a formal currency in God's world, what would it look like? Well, I'm going to tell you that. It wouldn't be gold. It's not silver, not platinum, not even paper. Instead, it's peace, love, mercy, grace, compassion, and justice. We are to give ourselves absolutely to God. And when we do that, we then transform our very diverse and divided loyalties. That's so common today. And then, and only then when we do that, are we freely able to give to others in a way that is gracious and life-giving. It is not about us. It's all about God. And we let go of ways that are distorted and destructive. But we all know what happens in real time, right? We get busy paying the bills. We get busy trying to do a good job at work. We get busy trying to be the best volunteer there is even at the church. We get busy raising kids, serving on any and all communities, preparing for retirement, keeping up with the favorite NFL team, go Chiefs. And often what gets left out then is our relationship with God. We have to reconsider our priorities, people. It's God's grace and love. It's the love and the peace and the presence of the Holy Spirit that's going to make the difference in our lives. When we put God first, everything else is going to fall into its rightful place. Listen to these words from Matthew 6. Strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So opera great Luciano Pavarotti said that when he was a boy, his father, who was a baker, introduced him to the wonders of music. He heard this talent in his son's voice, and he urged Pavarotti to work hard to develop his voice. So Arrigo Polo, who was a very professional tenor in Pavarotti's hometown of Modena, Italy, took on Pavarotti as a student. But Pavarotti also enrolled in a teacher's college. He just wanted to make sure all the bases were covered. And when he graduated from teacher's college, he asked his father, "Should I be a teacher or a singer?" And his father replied, "If you try to sit on two chairs, you will fall between them. When it comes to life, you must choose one chair." Well, Pavarotti later in life wrote this, "I chose one. Took 7 years of study and frustration before I even made my first professional appearance. And it took another 7 to reach the Metropolitan Opera. And I think whether it's laying bricks, writing a book, whatever we choose, we should give ourselves to it, because commitment, that's the key. Choose one chair." Or in the terms of stewardship, it's simple. We are to only choose God. God is to be first. There's always going to be issues to address. Taxes, relationships, war, personal finances, marriage, children, loss. I mean, that list just goes on and on and on, right? We have to be very careful that when we're dealing with the issues that we feel are right in front of us, that we don't easily forget in whose image we were formed. We are to be faithful in our walk with Christ, because faithfulness means we are continually learning to surrender and render ourselves to God first. So this is your question today. To whom do you belong? I know sometimes you might feel like you belong to Caesar. Taxes, limits on freedoms. Sometimes maybe you feel like you're owned by your job, your family, even your material possessions. In fact, that's what happens with George Bailey in It's a Wonderful Life. In fact, I can just hear George singing this old song. "You load 16 tons, and what do you get? Another day older and deeper in debt. St. Peter, don't you call me, 'cause I can't go. I owe my soul to the company store." My kids would have no clue about that song. Have you ever felt that way? You owe your soul to mortgages, credit cards, expectations, taxes, family, obligations of all sorts that's owning you. But Jesus says, no, you owe your soul, all that you are, all that you have, to God. So all we are, all we have, all that we hope for and to be belongs to God. We are imprinted with the image of God. And how we spend our time, how we spend our resources, how we spend our life's energy, all of that impacts the way we bear that image. We have to take the sacred trust that God has in it and invest it in worship of God. Sometimes that's worship that occurs privately in your home in devotion. Sometimes it's like this morning here in church with your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. But the rest of the time, that worship occurs in the sphere of your daily work, life, and service. Because every second and every breath you take is about worship. So this week, remember, we each bear the image of God, and share the joy of knowing that. Laugh, dance, love, help. Because you see, the crazier the brokenness of this world gets, the more important it is for each and every one of us to have a perspective check and recognize all the wonder and the glory that comes from God that surrounds us in the midst of that craziness. That's how we can have a wonderful life. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give unto you all that we are and all that we have. Remind us, all the other stuff is human made. You made us. And you have a job that you need us to do. We thank you for this, God, and your willingness to continually to put up with us when we break that rule and promise with you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Offering prayer now. Gracious God, looking back, we see the generosity of those who came before us, acknowledging their hardships and struggles, their joys and gains that bring us to the place we are now. And looking back, help us to build a foundation for those who will look back at our lives, those who will be affected by what we do, what we offer, and what we give. Help us to rejoice in the knowledge that lives are being changed now and in the future because of what we are able to do with this collective offering. In the name of the one who calls us to the loyalty of justice, Jesus the Christ, amen.
We have multiple ways that you can give your offering. One is if you're here present with us, of course you can give it in the offering plates that are going by. You can do so by going online on our webpage, which is lakehillsumc.org. There's a link there that you can give, and you can also mail your check to the church. Know that what you put in that plate, we use here to worship God, to show others God's love. We've got bags of socks that show that, right? On top of all the other missions and ministry this church is part of. Thank you. One of the ways that we remember how amazing God is when we come to the table. Because you see, it's through simple pieces of bread and juice that we are reminded of the greatest gift that God has ever given us, and that is His Son, Jesus, who is our Lord and our Savior. We are reminded of that as we remember these words. We find a scripture that says, on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took a loaf of bread. He broke the bread. He gave thanks to you, God. And then he gave the bread to those around him, saying, take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And then when supper was over, Jesus took a cup and he filled it with wine. And he again gave thanks to you, God. And then he passed that cup around to his disciples and he said, take, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. Let us pray. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit on all who are gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. As we remember, God, that we are made in your image, make them be for us the body of Christ, so that we can be the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. God, make us one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, doing the work that you have called us to do. Help us to lean further into what it means to be stewards of your amazing gifts. We pray this now as we pray those words Jesus taught his disciples to pray, words that guide our lives, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As you come forth for communion, do so knowing God is calling us all on a path to increase our stewardship. You will be given a piece of bread. All elements are gluten-free. You'll be given a cup, and then you can put the cup here into the trash can. Our COVID numbers are going down, which is such a blessing. Sadly, the deaths are going up. So we are still asking everyone to just refrain from kneeling at the altar, because touching and just trying to keep everybody healthy and as much as we can. Come, receive as the Spirit leads you.
So let go.
frozen wind still know his name. The waves and wind still know his name.
Thank you, God, for this meal that you prepared for us. Allow it to nourish our bodies so that we can go in to your communities and help nourish others in the name of Christ the Lord. Amen. Before we sing our final praise song, there's a few announcements. Today is the last Sunday of the month. That's why we have our church here. I know we sing a song, and I, for the life of me, cannot remember the name, the words. So I'm going to need to have you all help me. I know it's to the tune of Happy Birthday. Right? Right, so happy birthday anniversaries. This is a blessing church, basically. If you've been blessed, if you've had an anniversary, a birthday, if you've just been blessed this month, this is a way you can just kind of help share those blessings. You come forth as we're singing the song, or you can do it after worship and just put a gift of blessing here. Let us sing that song, if I can remember. It goes, happy birthday to you, an anniversary to God bless you and keep you in all that you do. I'm watching Jackie. Yay, we remembered. Thank you all. Today is, we're still taking up donations for Thanksgiving baskets for Hill Country Daily Bread, which is an ecumenical ministry we are in. We have been tasked to purchase rolls, and those don't keep well, so we're giving a monetary donation to Hill Country Daily Bread for 400 families in the area. So please pray about that, how God lays it on your heart. Just annotate that on your check, or if you give online, whatever the case may be. We are participating in tonight's Trail and Treat at Lake Hills Library, starting from 5 to 7. It's going to be a great time of costumes and candy. If you can help with that, that would be fantastic. This Friday, November 5th, we will be celebrating the life of Fan Bitten at 12 o'clock noon. And then on the following day, Saturday, November 6th, we'll be remembering the life of Richard Lewis at 1 p.m. Please keep the families of both of these individuals in your prayer. And if you can attend one or the both of those services, I know it will mean so much to those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Next Sunday is daylight savings time. You get an hour. I got so excited. You get an extra hour of sleep, right? So set your clock back 1 hour before you go to bed on Saturday. Next Sunday is also All Saints Sunday. We're going to be remembering those in our church and those in your lives who now live with God in their heavenly home. And if you're watching this on the live stream, you may want to consider having a candle or two to light in your home next Sunday. The Lake Hills United Methodist Church members are going to be remembering our Fan Benton, Mike Boggs, Johnny Giles, Mary Alice Henry, Antonio or Tony Casada, Nancy Ross, Nick Smith, Cindy Stein, and Tom Walton. So if you notice that we have left off a name of one of our church family members that has passed away since last October, please let me or Deborah in the office know as soon as possible so that we can recognize them next Sunday. Sunday, November 14th, we will be celebrating Veterans Day, and we'll be honoring all of our military veterans at both services. We're also having a church-wide meeting between our two worship services on that day. The meeting will begin at 9:30, so come and eat breakfast. We'll celebrate what has happened over the past year or so here at Lake Hills, but what to excitedly anticipate and celebrate where God is leading us as a church to go in the upcoming year. Advent is just around the corner. Wow. First Sunday of Advent is November 28th, the Sunday after Thanksgiving. That means our choir, as well as the Hill Country Samaritans Choir, are starting rehearsals. One for our Christmas cantata and for the Hill Country Samaritans Christmas concert. Our choir practices on Wednesday at 6:30. We still need people to help do scripture readings during that service. So if that's something you can help with, please see me for more information. Or see Risa Martin, she can help with that also. Hill Country Samaritans is beginning their practices this Friday at 6 p.m. They'll be serving pizza to anyone who attends at 6 and then followed by rehearsal. We're hitting a busy time of year, but God is amazing and great, and even in the craziness of it, we're going to keep worshiping God, because that's what we do. Let us now stand as we sing our final song of praise. Go forth serving others, knowing that you are the image of God, and so it's in your words, your thoughts, your actions, and deeds. that others come to know who God is. Oh, one announcement I did forget. There's a shopping cart out in the vestibule, in the entryway. You'll notice food in this basket. We are starting up our own food pantry here at Lake Hills. That's in conjunction with what we do with, separate from what we do with Hill Country Daily Bread. But there's often people who have an immediate need for food. So we are starting that up. We will have a shopping cart out in the entryway each Sunday where you can bring food donations of non-perishable items to help stock our pantry. And if you'd like to have more information or help, Kenny is standing in the back. I'll have her wave her hand and you can ask her about that, okay? Let us now sing, So God So Loved the World.
Go first to serve God in all that you do.
Waiting there with open arms.
For God so loved.
For God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live forever. The power
bless y'all.